गुड आफ्टरनून। यस्टरडे कंप्लीट अप टू द क्लस्टर्ड सिस्टम्स। नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू एक्सप्लेन ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम स्ट्रक्चर। The operating system structure is divided into multi-programming systems and time-sharing systems. What is a multi-programming system? Here, an operating system provides the environment within which multiple programs are executed. So, for the sake of executing multiple programs, operating system provides an environment. In modern computing systems, there are usually several concurrent application processes which want to execute several concurrent application processes. What is meant by concurrency? Concurrency is nothing but at a time more than one process are going to be executed and more than one process are going to share same resources. Let me take one best example. Suppose whenever our results came, when we are going to search our roll number or registration number, at that time, sometimes the server may hang. The results could not appear because the same database, so many people are going to request their results. So, number of people concurrently requesting the same resource. Sorry. Requesting the same resource. Like people like you, all the students are going to search their results, but the server is same. So many requests came from different clients, and server has to respond at a time. Server being a multi-processing system, at a time the server may respond up to 20 people or 30 people, but thousands of people are going to search their results at the same time. So concurrently, you people are going to search your result from the same database. So at that time, multi-programming plays a vital role. One of the most important aspects of operating systems is the ability to multi-program. It is the best advantage because a single user cannot in general keep either CPU or IO devices busy at all times. But multi-programming increases CPU utilization by organizing jobs. So that the CPU always has one to execute. What it means? Never ever CPU is going to be ideal. Every time CPU must execute any of the processes. If no processes are going to be executed in CPU, then operating system comes into picture and gives some instructions to CPU because CPU never going to be ideal. If CPU is going to be ideal, then what is the purpose of using this multi-programming or multi-processor systems? So CPU never ideal. So multi-programming increases CPU utilization by organizing jobs, code and data, so that the CPU always has one to execute. The idea is as follows. The operating system keeps several jobs in memory simultaneously. Observe figure 1.7. So here, what the operating system is doing, whatever may be the jobs, the operating system take all those jobs and those jobs are placed in a queue one by one. So the operating system keeps several jobs in memory simultaneously. This set of jobs can be a subset of the jobs kept in the job pool. What it is called as job pool. Job 1, job 2, job 3, job 4, so on, job n. This is called as job pool. In the job pool, operating system maintains all the jobs. Depending on the request by the user, the operating system is going to execute that job. Sometimes, if kernel requests gives highest priority job 4, then first job 4 is going to be executed, because in operating system there is a priority given to kernel, because kernel is heart of the operating system. That's why the highest priority is given to kernel. So what is the process going here? Observe. The operating system picks and begins to execute one of the jobs in memory. Here it is memory. How much memory it is having? 512 KB. In this memory, the operating system picks and begins to execute one of the jobs in memory. From this memory, operating system picks one job. Picking of the job maybe depends on first come first service, or shortest job first, or priority, or round robin. These four are algorithms, CPU scheduling algorithms. We discuss these algorithms whenever they comes into picture. But for the sake of understandability, you simply observe. The CPU may take jobs, the operating system may take jobs depending on these four situations. First one, first come, first service, means whichever may be the job comes into picture, that job may be going to execution. Second one, shortest job first, that means whatever may be the job is having less amount of time and less memory, that job is going to execute, because if it is having less memory, automatically the job is going to execute very fast. So among these four jobs, which job is having shortest job time, that job is going to be executed. And third case, priority. By giving these jobs, and operating system is also giving some priority. Suppose for job 1, first priority, job 2, fourth priority, job 3, second priority, job 4, third priority. If given like this, observe. Suppose for job 1, fourth priority, job 2, third priority, job 3, second priority, job 4. Suppose if you given like this, So first, which job is going to be executed? Job 4, because job 4 is having first priority. Like that, in the third case, whatever may be the priority is given, that job is going to be executed. So first job is going to execute job 4, second job is job 3, third job is job 2, and first job is job 1. Like that, the operating system is take the decision, that is priority algorithm, priority scheduling algorithm. Next, round robin. In the case of round robin, each and every time the operating system gives some memory. Each and every time the operating system gives some memory, so that suppose job 1 is going to execute for 2 minutes. After 2 minutes, job 2 is going to execute. Even though job 1 is completely executed or not executed, no problem. After 2 minutes of time, the operating system stops the execution of job 1 and give priority to job 2. And for this job 2 also, it is going to give 2 minutes. After 2 minutes, job 3 is going to be executed. Within 1 minute, suppose if job 2 is executed, automatically job 3 comes into picture. It takes its own 2 times. After that, job 4 comes into picture. Once the round robin process is over, then again priority goes to job 1, that is called round robin. Just for the sake of your understandability, I am saying that's it. In the next unit or upcoming chapters, we'll discuss thoroughly these scheduling algorithms, no problem. So the operating system picks and begins to execute one of the jobs in memory. Eventually, the job may have wait for some task, such as an IO operation to complete. Suppose if we want to take a printout, you give a request to printer, but already some person is going to taking the printouts, so your job is placed in queue. After completion of all the printouts from that person, then only your printout comes into picture. So for the sake of IO operation, your job is going to be wait for some time. After the completion of the process of other person, then only your job is going to be executed. In a non-multi-programmed systems, the CPU would sit ideal. In multi-programmed systems, the operating system simply switches to and executes another job. So in non-multi-programmed system, there is only one program executed. So another program must have to wait, or sometimes the CPU going to be ideal. But in the case of multi-programming system, we are having multiple programs. So that multiple programs are executed simultaneously. Then every time any one of the job is going to execute in CPU. So CPU never behaves ideal. The operating system simply switches to and executes another job. When the job needs to wait, the CPU is switched to another job. If the job is going to wait for some time, the CPU switch that job to another job, because the job is going to wait for some other IO operation. So at that time, CPU may be in ideal position. So operating system observes this situation, and operating system allocate one more job to that CPU. The first job finishes waiting and gets CPU back. If the first job waiting process is completed, then it comes back into CPU. As long as at least one job needs to execute, the CPU is never ideal. Most important point, the CPU is never ideal. Please observe, the CPU is never ideal. The most important thing in multi-program system is the CPU is never ideal. Next, coming to observe. Multi-programmed systems provide an environment in which the various system resources, for example, what are all the resources available here? CPU, memory, and peripheral devices. CPU, central processing unit, memory, RAM, or hard disk, all those things, and peripheral devices, whatever may be the devices, either hardware devices like printers, fax machines, webcams, like that, are utilized efficiently or effectively, but they do not provide for user interaction with the computer. They never provide user interaction to the computer. This is about multi-programming systems. Next, coming to time sharing systems or multitasking. Time sharing is a logical extension of multi-programming systems. In time sharing systems, the CPU executes multiple jobs by switching among them. Suppose in CPU there are 100 jobs are going to executed at the time. CPU gives time sharing. For one process, it will give 5 minutes of time, another process next 5 minutes, another process next 5 minutes. Like that, CPU gives certain time to the processes are going to be executed. That is called time sharing system. So, multiple jobs by switching among them, but the switches occur so frequently that the user can interact with each program while it is running. Whenever the program is in the running state, there may be several jobs switching from one position to another position. Next, time sharing requires interactive or hands-on computer system which provides direct communication between the user and the system. In the case of multi-programming system, the user role is very less. But when compared with time sharing system, the user must communicate with the system. So, the time sharing system provides direct communication between the user and the system. It plays a vital role. Suppose if your system is going to be hanged at the time, the system gives an acknowledgement to the user so that it is going to be hanged. By seeing that one, we have to do some restart operation or anything else. So the system always in communication with the user in time sharing system. Accordingly, the response time should be short, typically less than 1 second. When you go for this time sharing systems, the response time is also very quick, so that it will be very much useful in multi-processing systems. A time shared operating system allows many users to share the computer simultaneously. The one more biggest advantage is a time shared operating system allows many users to share the computer simultaneously. So whenever you are going to your software industry, it plays a vital role, computer sharing. So our computer or our laptop is going to share so much of data from the server at the time client server system may be needed. In some situations, if server is busy, then the network administrator or database administrator is going to allocate some other person's memory or some other person's data should be shared with another person. So at that time, because of server busy, the data sharing is given to some other person's laptop. So at that time, if you use time shared operating systems, it will give a sharing facility to the computer simultaneously. A time shared operating system uses CPU scheduling and multi-programming to provide each user with a small portion of time shared computer. Suppose 10 people want to share one computer. At that time, what we will do? For 1 hour, the computer becomes one person. After that, second person is going to share that computer. After that, third computer will add. After that, fourth person. Like that, we have to give certain time period. After like this, we are giving a time period. This is called, that's why the operating system provides a small portion of time shared computer to each and every user. Each user has at least one separate program in memory. Because the user is going to share the computer, so for that purpose, each user must have at least a separate program in the memory, so that the memory, the program is going to be executed. That's why his time will come. So a program loaded into memory and executing is called as a process. What is a process? So many companies, whenever you are going campus placements, the question may occur like this: what is a process? A process is nothing but a program loaded into memory and executing is called as a process. Sometimes a process which is under execution is called as a program. Reverse also they will ask, what is a program? A program is nothing but a process which is under execution. What is a process? A program loaded into memory and executing is called as a process. So sometimes interviewer may be asked this type of confusing questions. What is a job pool? We already discussed what is a job pool. Operating system kept all those jobs into a job pool. All these jobs into a job pool. So time sharing system and multi-programming require several jobs to be kept simultaneously in memory, since in general memory is too small to accommodate all jobs. The jobs are kept initially on the disk in the job pool. So if we consider our RAM, is having very low memory space. Whenever we are using this time shared system, we are going to share a system with many users. So suppose if 100 users are sharing same system, automatically 100 programs of the users are going to be executed or are in memory. See, each user has at least one separate program in memory. If we are having 100 users, there may be 100 programs in memory. So maintaining 100 programs in general memory is difficult. General main memory is difficult. For that purpose, they are using disk. Our hard disk, all these programs are going to stored in the job pool. Wherever the jobs are stored, that thing is called as job pool. So operating system stores all the jobs in the job pool by using the hard disk memory. This pool consists of all processes residing on disk awaiting allocation of main memory. All these jobs are stored away in the job pool. But when the situation comes for a job, whenever the job in main memory, then only the job is going to be executed. So this pool consists of processes residing on disk awaiting. So these are all jobs awaiting for allocation of main memory. Whenever a main memory is allocated to a job, then only the job is going to be executed. So job pool, the operating system takes jobs on the main memory only. So the job pool maintaining all the jobs. Whenever the CPU memory is free, whenever the main memory is free, one job is going to be stored from the job pool. After the job is going to execute, after the job is execution is completed, then another job is going to reside in main memory. Like that, the process is going. If several jobs are ready to be brought into memory, and if there is not enough room for all of them, then the system must choose among them. If so many jobs are wanted to be placed in main memory, at that time there is no space. So the operating system itself takes a decision that which job I have to take among the all these jobs. So here the role of operating system comes into picture. Making this decision is called as job scheduling. For this job scheduling also in future we are having algorithms, but for the sake of understandability, what is job scheduling? Suppose if 100 jobs are going to share the same main memory location, but there is not enough space in main memory, at that time operating system is going to decide which job is going to main memory. That type of scheduling is called as job scheduling. Who will take care of this job scheduling? Our operating system will take care about this job scheduling. When the operating system selects a job from the job pool, automatically it loads that job into memory for execution. So those jobs, please understand, it is most important, those jobs who are in main memory, they are only going to load the programs into main memory and they are only going for execution. No other jobs are going to execution. Only those jobs resides in main memory, that jobs only going to be executed once the main memory is free. In addition, if several jobs are ready to run at the same time, the system must choose among them. Making this decision is called CPU scheduling. If several jobs are ready to run at the same time, the system must choose among them. So, already several jobs are in main memory. Already several jobs, suppose in 100 jobs, already 20 jobs are in main memory. From 100 to selecting 20 jobs is called job scheduling. Now all 20 jobs are in main memory, so all jobs are going to run at the same time. If it is the case, then CPU must schedule. So here CPU will select one or two jobs. The type of decision is called as CPU scheduling. So observe here two types of schedulings. First one, job scheduling, and second one, CPU scheduling. If our hard disk having 100 jobs and among those 100 jobs we are going to store 10 jobs in main memory, so the type of decision is taken by operating system, that is called as job scheduling. Transferring jobs from our hard disk to main memory is called as job scheduling. And what is CPU scheduling? Selecting one job from already the jobs are in main memory. Among those 20 jobs in main memory, the CPU is going to select one job for execution. That is called CPU scheduling. If several jobs are ready to run at the same time, the system must choose among them. Making this decision is CPU scheduling. Next, time sharing systems is over. First one multi programming system, then time sharing system. These two are called, comes under operating system structure. Next concept, operating system operations or functions. Operating system operations, sometimes they are called as functions. So nowadays modern operating systems are interrupt driven, that is, if there are no processes to execute, no IO devices to service, and no users to whom to respond, an operating system will sit quietly waiting for something to happen. Events are almost always signaled by the occurrence of an interrupt or a trap. So operating system or CPU are never be ideal, never be ideal. If they are going to idle, then there is no work to do. So in a multi-processing systems or modern operating systems, these are all processes are interrupt driven. There must be an interrupt to execute the operating system, because the system, the operating system never be ideal, sits quietly. So a trap or an exception is a software generated interrupt caused either by error, for example division by zero or invalid memory access, or a specific request from a user program that an operating system service be performed. So what is an interrupt? Interrupt is nothing but a trap or an exception. Is a trap is a software generated interrupt caused either by an error. Suppose if you are writing a program, in that program if there may be a logical error or there may be a syntax error, if those type of errors will come, then automatically the system is in a stage, interrupted stage. For example, interrupted, the system is going to interrupted, for example division by zero or invalid memory access, full stop. Next, the interrupt driven nature of an operating system defines that system's general structure. For each type of interrupt, separate segments of code in the operating system determines what action should be taken. If we are having either hardware interrupt or software interrupt, whatever may be the interrupt, separate segments of code in the operating system is going to take an action. For each and every interrupt, there may be separate code. Depending on the code, the action will be taken by operating system. So an interrupt service routine, it will be discussed in the future class. It is called as ISR, interrupt service routine. Sometimes in our exams, they will ask, briefly explain about ISR. Simply they are asking ISR. They don't ask interrupt service routine. They simply ask, what is ISR? In GATE also, in GATE exam also, questions came like this. What is an ISR? Object type questions also came. Interrupt service routine. ISR means interrupt service routine. Next. Since the operating system and the users share the hardware and software resources of the computer system, we need to make sure that an error in a user program could cause problems only for the one program that was running. Suppose meeku manchi example odu cheptanu chudandi. Suppose ఒక డేటాబేస్ మీద మీరు వర్క్ చేస్తున్నారు అనుకున్నాం. ఒక డేటాబేస్ మీద ఒక 100 మెంబర్స్ ఎంప్లాయీస్ వర్క్ చేస్తున్నారు. ఈ 100 మెంబర్స్కి డేటా ప్రొవైడ్ చేయాలి అంటే సాఫ్ట్వేర్ ఇండస్ట్రీలో కంపల్సరీగా అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటర్ రోల్ కావాలి. సో అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటర్ పర్మిషన్స్ కావాలి. అన్లెస్ ఆర్ అంటిల్ దెర్ ఈజ్ నో అడ్మినిస్ట్రేషన్ పర్మిషన్స్, వీఆర్ అనేబుల్ టు డూ ఎనీ టైప్ ఆఫ్ ఆపరేషన్స్. if we want to do addition operation, or if we want to update any employee's salary, or if you want to remove any employee data, you must need administrator permission. Unless or until if there is no permission from the administrator, you can't do anything. So suppose there are 100 employees who are going to use the database. Administrator already given permission to these 100 employees. Among the 100 employees, one person is working on the increment of a person. Suppose 100 members lo oka developer employees increments meda work chestunnadamma. So aa data atanu teeskunnadu, atanu teeskoni client system lo dani meda coding chestunnadu. Suppose 1 year ayipoyina vallandarki increment icharu. Meanwhile atana data teeskuna vishayam teliyakunda inkoka developer em chesadante, ఎవరికైతే ఎక్కువ శాలరీ ఉందో వాళ్ళల్లో ఒక 10 మెంబర్స్ డేటాని కలెక్ట్ చేసి క్లయింట్కి పంపించాలనుకున్నాడు. సో దానికి అతను కోడ్ రాస్తున్నాడు. ఈ ఇంక్రిమెంట్ వల్ల ఒక పర్సన్కి ఎక్కువ శాలరీ వచ్చింది. ఆ ఎక్కువ శాలరీ వచ్చిన అతను ఈ 10 మెంబర్స్లో యాడ్ అవుతాడు, అందులో ఒకరు తగ్గిపోతారు. కానీ ఈ విషయం ఇద్దరికి మ్యూచువల్ కమ్యూనికేషన్ లేకపోతే ఆటోమేటిక్ ఏం జరుగుతుంది, తనేమో డేటా ఒకటి పంపిస్తాడు, అప్డేట్ అయిన తర్వాత ఇంకో డేటా ఉంటుంది. ఫైనల్గా క్లయింట్ అబ్జర్వ్ చేసేటప్పుడు ఆటోమేటిక్గా ఎర్రర్ వస్తుంది. సో వెన్ ఎవర్ వీఆర్ యూజింగ్ సచ్ టైప్ ఆఫ్ మల్టీ ప్రాసెసింగ్ సిస్టమ్స్, ఇఫ్ ఎనీ యూజర్ ఈజ్ గోయింగ్ ఆర్ ఎనీ డెవలపర్ ఈజ్ టేకెన్ ద డేటా ఫ్రమ్ ద డేటాబేస్ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటర్, ఇఫ్ సమ్ అదర్ పర్సన్ ఈజ్ గోయింగ్ టు ఆస్క్ ద డేటా, ఆటోమేటికల్లీ అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటర్ విల్ టెల్ already some other person is doing work. After his work is completed, then you will take the data, because the same data you are going to take, so the changes may reflect in the database. So 100 members lo evaraithe increment meda work chestunaro vaalla data vachina tarvata decision making ki pampicham ankonde adi efficient ga untadi. సో ఆ టైంలో అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటర్ ఏం చేస్తాడు, సేమ్ డేటాని షేర్ చేసుకుంటున్నా కానీ ఇది క్రూషియల్ ఆపరేషన్ కాబట్టి ఆ ఆపరేషన్ ఆ డేటా వర్క్ అయ్యేంతవరకు వచ్చేంతవరకు వెయిట్ చేయండి అని సమ్ అదర్ పర్సన్కి చెప్తాడు. సో సిన్స్ ద ఆపరేటింగ్ సిస్టమ్ అండ్ ద యూజర్స్ షేర్స్ ద హార్డ్వేర్ అండ్ సాఫ్ట్వేర్ రిసోర్సెస్ ఆఫ్ ద కంప్యూటర్ సిస్టమ్, వీ నీడ్ టు మేక్ షూర్ దట్ ఎన్ ఎర్రర్ ఇన్ ఎ యూజర్ ప్రోగ్రామ్ కుడ్ కాజ్ ప్రాబ్లమ్స్ ఓన్లీ దట్ ప్రోగ్రామ్. సో ఆ యూజర్కి మాత్రమే ప్రాబ్లం రావాలి ఎవరైతే ఆ డేటా తీసుకున్నారో. సపోజ్ ఎనీ ప్రాబ్లం అక్కర్స్ ఫర్ దట్ యూజర్ ఓన్లీ ఫేస్ ద ప్రాబ్లం ఆఫ్టర్ ద ఆఫ్టర్ రికవరీ ఫ్రమ్ ద ఎర్రర్స్ దెన్ హీ విల్ అగైన్ అప్లోడ్ ద కోడ్ ఇన్ టు సర్వర్ దెన్ సమ్ అదర్ పర్సన్ విల్ టేక్ దట్ డేటా. సో దిస్ ఈజ్ అబౌట్ ఆపరేటింగ్ సిస్టమ్ ఆపరేషన్స్ అండ్ హియర్ డ్యూయల్ మోడ్ ఆపరేషన్. వాట్ ఈజ్ డ్యూయల్ మోడ్ ఆపరేటింగ్ సిస్టమ్ ఆపరేషన్స్? డ్యూయల్ మోడ్ ఆపరేషన్, టైమర్ ఆపరేషన్, టూ ఆపరేషన్స్ ఆర్ దేర్. ఫస్ట్ వన్ డ్యూయల్ మోడ్ ఆపరేషన్. సి వాట్ ఈజ్ డ్యూయల్ మోడ్ ఆపరేషన్? In order to ensure the proper execution of the operating system, we must be able to distinguish between the execution of operating system code and user defined code. There are two types of codes, user defined code and operating system code. So user defined code is nothing but user process is nothing but a program which is under execution. Code is nothing but the number of lines in the program is called as code. So user process or user code. Whenever a user wants to do any operation, at that time dual mode operation, kernel comes into picture. Kernel is nothing but heart of operating system. So our operating system and user program both are going to be executed. If any time whatever may be the time. If a user wants to execute a program, he must have permissions from the operating system. Unless or until the communication with the operating system, we can't do anything. If any process is going to be executed, that process will check with the operating system, is any program, some other program is in main memory or not. If the program is not in main memory, then operating system gives response, you can come and execute your process, because there is no process in CPU. Sorry. So whenever the user executing a process, at the time automatically the system call goes to the kernel, nothing but operating system, and the kernel execute that request, and the response will be given to the system call, so that operating system, the user process, completes its execution. It is called a dual mode. So at the very least, we need two separate modes of operation. First one, user mode, and second one, kernel mode. The dual mode is nothing but first one, user mode, and second one, kernel mode. This kernel mode is also called as supervisor mode, or system mode, or privileged mode. So whenever a user wants to execute a process, he must need the permission of the kernel, because kernel mode is a supervisor mode. Because the kernel mode is supervisor mode. What is the role of the supervisor? Supervise all the situations, or supervise all the processes supervise all the users, supervise the all the jobs, all those things will be taken care by the supervisor. So here kernel mode acts as a supervisor. A bit called mode bit is added to the hardware of the computer to indicate the current mode. So if the current mode is 0, then it comes under user mode. If the current mode is 1, then it is called as user mode. Current mode is 0, it is called as kernel mode. If current mode is 0, it is called as kernel mode. If current mode is 1, it is called as user mode. So how user mode becomes 1? Whenever user going to execute any program, automatically the operating system calls a system call, and the system call gives request to kernel. At that time the mode bit becomes 0. Whenever the execution of system call is over, automatically this mode bit 1 changes to mode bit 0 changes to mode bit 1. Whenever the mode bit changes to 1, automatically it's sent to user mode, because in user mode only the mode bit is 1. But in the case of kernel mode, the mode bit is 0. So whenever the user process is having 0, automatically it will communicate with the kernel, and the system call is going to be executed. After the system call execution over, automatically this 0 is converted into 1. Whenever mode bit becomes 1, automatically it is called as user mode. Like that, dual mode operation is going to done here. That is all about. Next, timer. We must ensure that the operating system maintains control over the CPU. We must ensure that operating system maintains control over the CPU. So every time there must be a control. CPU never be ideal. If CPU is going to ideal, our operating system automatically gives one process to that one. If you observe in control panel, there is a services option. In that services, sometimes automatically our softwares are going to start in automated mode. If you observe in go to control panel, in that control panel there is one option like services. Please select that service. What are all the softwares installed in your system? All those software services are going to show here in the services section. So automatically some of the softwares are started in service section itself. Whenever you press power button in your laptop or system, the bootstrap program is going to execute. Whenever the bootstrap program execution completed, automatically whatever may be the application programs you installed, all those programs stored into memory, then only the program is going to be executed. So for that purpose, operating system every time controls the CPU. We must prevent a user program from getting stuck in an infinite loop or not calling system services. So to accomplish this goal, we can use a timer. So every 60 seconds or every 1 minute, the timer is going to execute and the timer says that CPU is not going to be ideal. So for every 1 minute, for every one minute, operating system allocate one process to CPU so that the CPU is going to be executed. If there are processes are executing in CPU, no problem at all. If CPU is going to be ideal, for every 1 minute, automatically the operating system interrupts the CPU and gives some other process to execute. A variable timer is generally implemented by fixed rate clock and a counter. So this variable timer must have a fixed rate counter. So the operating system sets the counter. Who will set the counter? The operating system sets the counter. Every time the clock ticks, the counter is decremented. When the counter reaches to zero, an interrupt occurs. Whenever the interrupt occurs, automatically the operating system is going to execute that interrupt. We can use the timer to prevent a user program from running too long. Whenever a user program is taking too much of time for the sake of running or for the sake of execution, automatically we call a timer. Whenever you call a timer, after counter becomes zero, automatically the timer introduces an interrupt. Whenever there is an interrupt, the executing program will stop their execution and whatever may be the process is having interrupt, that process is going to be executed. Now coming to process management. So I will discuss this process management concept tomorrow, no problem. Till now, what are all the concepts we discussed today? Today we discussed two topics. One is operating system structure. In operating system structure, there are two types. First one is multi-programming system and second one is time sharing system. And after that, operating system operations or functions, dual mode operation, and second one is timer. We will discuss process management tomorrow. Thank you, one and all.